Welcome, everyone. Welcome, friends on Facebook. So lovely to have you with us in our digital learning space this evening. And welcome all of you that are with us on Zoom. We are so thrilled to kick off our in-between classes this evening. And we are truly, truly in for an incredible evening that I believe will be both uplifting, enlightening, and hopefully inspire us as we begin to do our own work of tshuva, our process of return and renewal during these 10 days of awe. Just so you know, every weekday evening, so Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, we will be having our in-between classes here on Zoom at 7 p.m. And we have different themes and speakers each and every night. And the idea is to give you a unique form of inspiration and learning as we continue to do this soul searching. And without further ado, I turn it over now to our temple president, Stuart Sweet, who is going to introduce our special guest this evening.
Thank you, Rabbi. I can think of no more worthy people to kick things off than our first two presenters tonight. Most of us know Dr. Philip Gold as a past president of Congregation Emmanuel and welcome presence at our services. He, along with Michael Kress, are two of the people I try hardest to emulate in my term as president. Dr. Gold sits as Emeritus Professor of Medicine at Loma Linda University and Vice Chair of Medicine for Humanities. His distinguished medical career spans over half a century. He and his wife, Roberta, came to Redlands in 1970 and raised three children in our congregation. Although he rarely plays now, he has been an avid rugby player. Today, he prefers reading, opera, and fly fishing. Dr. Elizabeth Raskin is a newer part of our congregational family, but we are just as thrilled to have her in our hearts. Dr. Raskin hails originally from Los Angeles, but grew up in Las Vegas. Her medical training came while spending time in my hometown of Boston, Mass., and at the University of Minnesota. She now practices as staff surgeon at UC Davis in Sacramento. She and her husband, Ryan, enjoy spending time with their three children, and amazingly, she finds time after a full day at work and at home to garden, exercise, bake, and read. I give you Dr. Phil Gold and Dr. Elizabeth Raskin.
Thanks, Stuart. It is really exciting to see so many people here. One of my worries was that nobody would come. And what was wonderful about this process, and I want to thank Rabbi Resnick so much for making this sort of a professional shidduch, because although I've met Elizabeth a couple of times at the temple and enjoyed some of her cupcakes last year, we didn't really know each other very well. And during the past week, we've found a lot of commonalities. I mean, she's a girl, I'm a boy, she's a surgeon, and I'm an internist. But one of the things that we're both passionate about is medicine, and we're both medical educators. And in addition, one of the things that we've been focusing on is what's called narrative medicine. We might talk about that later on. And finally, we're both rugby players. And so it's really been a pleasure and a tremendous learning experience, actually, to spend this past week or two talking about what we were going to talk to you about this evening. Elizabeth.
Thank you, everybody, for having me. And this is a wonderful opportunity to talk about things that Phil has listed off. But I couldn't agree more that this was such a fabulous pairing that Rabbi has brought Phil and I together to learn more about each other. And as Phil pointed out, we are always rugby players for life. And once a rugby player on a team, you're a teammate for life. So we share that commonality, that sort of spirit and kind of sucking the marrow out of life mentality. And tonight we're going to be talking about the good doctor. And Phil has asked me to basically set the intention or our goals for this evening. And really what we're going to talk about are the attributes of a good physician and the importance of communication and recognizing really that sacred relationship that should exist between the physician and the patient. And we're going to go through some examples in culture. We're going to go through some storytelling, and hopefully we can share some questions and answers at the end of the talk to hear a little bit about each of your thoughts about the physician-patient relationship. So take it away, Phil.
Thank you. Just give me a moment and I'm going to share my screen with all of you. I don't know if you can see this. All of a sudden, I've lost everything here.
You need to go and share the other screen.
Okay, hold on for a second.
I think up at the view options, up at the top of your screen.
Uh-huh.
To your right, where it says view options.
Okay. Sorry about this little technical glitch here.
It wouldn't be a Zoom talk without this little segue. This happens in every Zoom talk, so we're using it as a breathing moment to set the intention for the humor that can also exist when we all get together. So
I'm looking at right now a screen that shows basic, advanced, and files.
So allow me. What you want to do is launch your PowerPoint. Make sure that it's in your presentation mode. Launch it. Hit the F5 button to go into presentation mode. And then when you go to share screen, choose basic, and you should see the PowerPoint window as one of your choices.
Okay. Well, give me a minute here because this is not working as I intended.
Not to worry, it happens to the best of us all the time, Phil. And like Dr. Raskin said, Dr. Gold, it's just part of our life while we live in this digital arena, learning to be more patient and learning to navigate a whole new world.
Okay, well, you can navigate with me in just a moment then.
So while Phil is looking for the PowerPoint, anybody want to share a reason why they wanted to tune in this evening? Anybody have something that they want to share about this topic?
This is Bonnie Conowich. Phil is one of my heroes, and anything he says is wise. So I'm here for him.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you, Dr. Raskin.
Awesome. Nice to meet you. Josie, did you want to say something?
Yep. So actually, I'm using Josie's computer. She's my daughter. I'm Rachel.
Rachel.
And hi, thanks for calling on me. I work at for an academic medical center located in Burlington, Vermont, University of Vermont Medical Center, even though I live here. So I've been remote for a while. And obviously, patient family engagement is really first, at the forefront in everything that we do at the medical center. And I know that it's just beneficial in so many ways. I also volunteer in Irvine for something called the Patient Safety Movement Foundation. And patient and family engagement and that relationship between the provider and the patient and the family members is really like the underpinning of so much. So was just really interested to see your perspectives on that tonight.
Thanks for that. That's fabulous that you're doing that sort of work. And the truth is, and Phil will probably agree, this is an area that we're talking about, physician-patient relationship, where we don't do as well as we should in training our new medical students, our residents, and our physicians for the future. And this is what we hope to start doing more of. And look at Phil, he did it.
Yay. So,
the content.
Well, one of the things that we wanted to do, as Elizabeth said, is actually to spend some time thinking about what doctoring means and what good doctoring is. I don't know how many of you have watched the television program called The Good Doctor, but one of the things that you learn if you watch this program, which actually is somewhat of a soap opera, but they have some amazing medical stories too and some very cutting edge technology. The star of the program is Dr. Sean Murphy. And Sean is extraordinarily well-intentioned. He is devoted to his craft. He wants to become a surgeon. He's a resident in a fictional hospital in San Jose. Sean's problem is that he suffers from some part of the autism spectrum. And consequently, although he's a savant and he's got enormous background in terms of knowledge and great technical skill, has this capacity to actually visualize things in three or even four dimensions and create some marvelous surgical saves, Sean really doesn't get it when it comes to communicating with people. He doesn't like to be touched. He doesn't touch people. And he will frequently blurt out things that are totally inappropriate and at times may even drive patients away. And on the other end of the spectrum is one of his resident colleagues, Dr. Claire Brown. Claire's had a tough life. Her mother's addictive personality and codependent. And Claire's had a lot of unsatisfactory romances. But what she does have is enormous skill at communicating and reaching out to people and empathizing and getting their stories and telling stories. And what's interesting is that both of these qualities of technical excellence, knowledge, as well as empathy are so important to the good physician is that we expect most doctors to have both of them. And what we want to talk about now is what else we can expect from a good doctor. And Elizabeth's going to talk to you a little bit about some of the attributes that we've talked about in the past several days and certainly agree on most strongly.
So Phil and I had the opportunity to brainstorm really this list of what we think the attributes of a good physician are. And they're more than what we could list here, but we felt that these were some of the pillars of what makes a good physician. And I think first and foremost, and you can ask most physicians, most residents, most medical students, why did they want to go into medicine? And there typically is a sense of calling or a sense of duty to help others that is a driving force behind that decision to embark on a career in medicine. Although it may not always seem that way, in the movies that we watch or the TV shows that we watch, humility needs to be at the heart of the physician, the good physician, because there are so many things that happen in the course of a patient's care or an individual's life that we are humbled by, things that we cannot control, things that we can't explain. And so to have a sense of humility is a strong attribute of a good physician. And that should come across when you speak to that individual. Empathy and compassion, obviously top or at the top of the list of attributes that really allow a physician to engage with his or her patient. We talk about the attributes of caring, of kindness, of mercy, of wanting to help others before really putting the patient at the center of the focus in every visit that transpires. I like the listing of integrity as an attribute of a good physician because it speaks to the character of an individual who takes all of this on and does it with a pure heart. And I think that we can't underscore that enough. When we think about wholeness, we are thinking about the physician looking at the patient, not only from the physical standpoint. They may present with a condition like a diabetes, and we can't look at this as a case of diabetes, but we need to look at it as the 55-year-old grandmother who worked in service her whole life, who has diabetes. This is a person, first and foremost. This is not a disease process. And when we look at wholeness, we're looking at healing the physical sense. We need to heal the psychological sense and the spiritual sense of a patient. And I think that's where this wholeness statement comes from. And then lastly, as I alluded to in one of our goals of this this talk, is to think about the sacred relationship that should exist between a physician and a patient. And this comes by really respecting a patient's privacy, by recognizing that it's a privilege to do what we do. It's a privilege to hear the stories of our patients, and it's a privilege to lay hands on an individual in a caring fashion. So this is a list that Phil and I came up with. There are many other attributes, but I think this is at the heart of what we're going to be talking about as we give examples today through our stories. Phil?
Well, since this is a synagogue program, absolutely essential that we mention the Rambam, Moses Maimonides, who is a scholar. He was the court physician to Saladin, and he was a brilliant philosopher as well. And what I wanted to focus on in the Oath of Maimonides, which some medical schools actually use in place of the Hippocratic Oath, are two of the articles within the oath. And one says, may the love for my art, and I want to stress the word art, actuate me at all times. We mentioned this already, but we want our doctors to have a sense of calling, to realize that they have a sacred duty to perform to their patients. And I think that's one of the things that Maimonides recognized. The other thing he talks about is may I never see in the patient anything but a fellow creature in pain. And we're going to be talking quite a bit this evening about empathy. And it's very appropriate that we honor Moses Maimonides in this talk, because I think he personified the good physician. So Elizabeth, talk about connection to us, and what are the factors that actually influence whether people are able to connect with one another?
Well, we talked about this together as we were making this list. At the heart of the connection is truly a curiosity that a physician has in the life of his or her patient, really a curiosity to know that individual, to understand their perspective, to understand the sort of symptoms they present with, and to be able to treat them in a whole way. The heart of it is the curiosity of that physician for that individual. I think that when we connect with patients, it can be a lot of different reasons, but when we connect and there's a sense of wonder and awe that transpires, this is what really, in my mind, highlights that sacred relationship between a physician and a patient, is when we are able to walk with them through the different phases of their life, through maybe the different chapters of their disease process, and even walk them through the dying process, there is a sense of wonder and awe that can happen that we don't have always the answers as to why it's occurring, but we know what the feeling is. And I think that that is something that many physicians, hopefully all physicians, will feel in their careers. We mentioned earlier this setting of intention, or Kavanaugh, basically a physician bringing to the interaction and setting the intention for that interaction. So an example that I use, and Phil and I talked about a lot, was when we start our surgery, when we take a patient to the operating room, there is a built-in pause session that is called the timeout. So first we huddle, And when we huddle, we bring a patient in the operating room and the patient is awake and not yet under anesthesia. And as a group, the anesthetists, the surgeons, the nurses, the technicians, we talk about the patient's plan and we engage the patients so that should he or she hear something that doesn't quite make sense, that that individual has the chance to ask questions. And then we do something called a timeout. So the patient is under anesthesia. We have prepared the field. The sterilization has happened of the skin. We've laid the towels and we're about to begin the surgery. We do something called the timeout. And this is our final pause before we begin the operation. And I have mentioned to Phil that that pause is a mandatory thing we do in the operating room. But for me, this is the final time that I set the intention for my team as to what we want to have happen. This is where I ask for help, for spiritual help, for the course of the procedure. This is where I try to get other thoughts outside of the surgery out of my mind so that I can focus with intention on the thing that I will take care of for that patient. So that connection is coming from the attention that we're giving. It's coming from the patience that we're giving. Now, when we see patients in the clinic, we use other senses and other physical signs to create a connection. And that includes eye contact. That includes the appropriate touching that we do to the patient, whether it's a hand on the shoulder or it used to be handshake. Now it might be elbow bump, but it's a way to connect in the least COVID-like physical way that that brings us together. It may be the expression we wear on our face, the body language we use, the gestures. You know, physicians have been taught not to keep their hands in their pockets because patients think that looks suspicious or they don't trust not seeing the hands of a physician. So I always try to have my hands visible or in a way or use and gesticulate with my hands in a way that is engaging to the patient. And then lastly, random acts of kindness. This is what we do when people aren't watching. These are the gestures that we give to the patient, to the family, to the staff we work at, the work that we work with, to show that our hearts are pure and our intentions are pure, and we hope that this connection will be a healing one. So that's our list for connection, although there's many other things. We hope to exemplify it in some of our stories.
Thanks, Elizabeth. I think this word kavana is so appropriate because there are tremendous similarities actually between a religious or spiritual experience and this relationship that we establish with patients. It is a sacred relationship, and it's one that occurs often in what is a sacred space. And I'm really delighted that you expressed that term. So we selected a story actually that might give you some idea of what we mean by making a connection. And I have the author's permission to read you this story. The author is Dr. Elizabeth Raskin. And the story is entitled The Siren and the Minotaur. And it's a story that she wrote when she was a senior medical student. And it's a compelling story. It's beautifully written. I think you'll enjoy it. The Minotaur was a bullish, thick-headed creature. He had hands the size of racquetball rackets that crushed oil cans like fortune cookies, but could dissect the finest tissues, handle the most friable cirrhosis, and decipher the most intricate anastomoses. He barked orders, complained about incompetent residents, and grumbled about sleep deprivation. He was indigestion, reflux, and lactose intolerance incarnate. He thought me an utter idiot, incompetent, lazy, and weak-spirited. He had the unique ability to stupefy me with a simple, answerable question, leaving me red hot in the face. He spat at my ignorance. His glance was vinegar. He regarded those around him as inferior, perhaps even indentured. In his eyes, no one was as diligent, dedicated, or determined as he. He trusted no one and respected only a few of his mentors. He was Hamlet, a solipsistic fellow, reigning over his hospital, his castle, his kingdom. Physically, he was a brick shithouse, philosophically a martyr, socially a tantrum-throwing tyrant. Yet he was tired and tormented. For this, I loved him fiercely. During the day, the Minotaur stormed the halls, sussing out abnormalities of laboratory tests and equilibrating electrolyte imbalances. When fecund petri dishes with multiple drug-resistant strains were reported, he would bellow for more thorough sensitivities. He juggled the minute details of cardiac enhancing drips, diuretics, and colloid solutions, dazzling the whole team with his complex mental calisthenics. He would insist on careful attention to detail. He did not praise, he did not nod his head in agreement. He reiterated that our best was not good enough by marching off to the next patient's room. I wondered if he knew pleasure. Perhaps being in itself was pleasurable to him. Perhaps he thrived by living life rapaciously. I could only imagine what drove him to perform day in and day out. Was it a burdensome magnetic force? Was it an opiate-like addiction? Was it a compulsion towards perfection with a take-no-prisoners mantra? I would never know. The Minotaur burrowed deep into life. Not only did he suck the marrow out of it, he reconfigured and spliced its DNA. But even Achilles had a heel. One night on call, I left my favorite note-writing pen down in Little Rosa Garcia Marquez's room. I journeyed down to the third floor in the wee hours of the morning to retrieve it. As I tiptoed across the room, fumbling around the dirty laundry container, a wooden rocking chair, I tried my best not to wake Rosa or her tiny 9-month-old roommate, Sonia. The curtains were pulled aside wide enough that the moon's light flooded Rosa's bedside. I could see my Bic 4000 with its luxurious gel grip. What I missed in the milky luminescence was Thomas the Tank Engine. With a purposeful and salivating lurch, I grasped for my pen, only to find Thomas underfoot. I tumbled backwards and hit my head with a thwack. Perhaps days went by, maybe seasons. When I finally came to, I hope I had Rip Van Winkled my way through medical school. But I still had a short white coat on, and Sonia was howling. I heard a nurse say, "She's at it again." And then a deep, husky voice replied that he would check in on her. A tearful siren, Sonia had beckoned the Minotaur, who whispered gently to her, "Sonia, my love, sweet, sweet baby. I am here, sweetheart." Although I recognized that I could indeed move my toes and feet, I remained paralyzed on the cool linoleum. He reached out to the bandaged and splinted infant. Her voice suddenly softened. Sonia had been intentionally burned with hot grease by her now incarcerated mother. Whether from pain or from her wounds or from fear and anxiety, she was inconsolable. No nurse could calm her. She relented only to the soothing of sedatives. The Minotaur, with his apish hands, reached into the crib and pulled Sonia out. As he nestled her against his broad chest, he sank into the creaky wooden rocker and whispered sweet nothings. "Sonia, my love, my beautiful, beautiful girl, don't cry, honey bear." And then he paused. In a faltering, tearful voice, he asked, "How could anyone want to hurt you? How could someone be such a monster?" And so he fathered the burned and scarred peanut into the early morning hours. One bottle of formula and a fresh pacifier later, the Minotaur and the siren were inseparable in each other's arms. Morpheus had escorted them both into the realm of peace and containment. I'm sure most of you were touched by that story, and I can't imagine anything telling us more about a connection than that story. Elizabeth, you want to comment?
You know, it. Each time I hear that story, I'm wondering how it's going to end because I don't remember writing it. I remember it happening, but the actual writing process is a little bit of a blur because that took place about 20 years ago. And strangely, it happened right where I'm working right now at UC Davis. I was a fourth year medical student doing a rotation on the burn surgery unit. And I was just so struck by the juxtaposition of this individual who seemed like maybe he couldn't care. And I knew that he really could. And so when that moment happened, it just burned in my mind a story that I knew I had to tell. So it was nice hearing that again, Phil. Thank you.
Well, I just wanted to share a little light relief with you because that was such a deep and in some ways a very sad but magnificent story. So this is what I wanted to share.
I won't get away with it twice.
Can I make an appointment for myself?
So I beg your indulgence, but I couldn't resist sharing that little example of another kind of connection. What was at work here were two things that are so important. And one is time. This doctor took lots and lots of time. And while that may be inefficient, actually that's not always the case. Sometimes going in up front and doing things like this saves a lot of time and aggravation at the back end. The other thing is that this doctor used his own personality. Many pediatricians have this kind of personality, unfortunately not all of them, but his own personality was actually a force of nature in this particular instance. So that brings us to the next story that we want to talk about, because we mentioned earlier that having a sense of awe and being able to reflect upon your work and your life is one of the essentials in terms of being a good doctor. And you might wonder what a story about Lazarus from the Gospels is doing in a Jewish learning center, but after all, Lazarus was Jewish, as were her sisters. And there's a lot to be learned from the parable. And one of the things that we want to share with you is Elizabeth's own story about Lazarus. And Elizabeth, take it away.
Sure. So as Phil and I came to get to know each other, one of the things that we really share a love for is this concept of narrative medicine, which is storytelling. And I've been a writer most of my life, and I've gotten even more inspired to write about the things that have happened. So true life experiences as a physician in training and a physician going through the different chapters of my career. And so I wrote a story entitled The Raising of Lazarus. And this is a true story that took place when I was a senior resident in general surgery in Boston. And many artists have told the story of Lazarus. And you can see here in the two paintings that Phil put on the slide of Rembrandt and Van Gogh's basically depiction. Mine is a little bit different, and I'm going to let you hear this story and you tell me what you think. The Raising of Lazarus. I knew the statistics well. In the summer alone, 26 homicides were recorded, marking 2006 as one of the deadliest years on record for Boston. Most of the victims were 20-something Black males from the Roxbury and Dorchester neighborhoods who had been beaten, stabbed, or shot. Boston Medical Center became the repository for those who survived long enough to be picked up by the paramedics, the innocent bystanders who were in the wrong place at the wrong time, and the bravado-laden retaliators. I met one of those victims in the emergency room. He arrived with a single gunshot wound to the chest. We futilely opened his chest while still in the trauma bay. 20 minutes later, we drew a clean white sheet over his body and went to find his family in the waiting room. Their screams and wails still haunt me. The young man's mother clung to my sleeve as she slumped to the cold linoleum. Tears streamed down his older brother's cheeks as he frantically paced back and forth. Why him? Why him? She pleaded. We had no answers, only condolences. A week later, in the same trauma bay, I almost met another casualty. You see, the Red Sox were off their game that night, and huddled in the residence lounge, we watched disappointedly as Beckett let three runs come in during the fourth inning. 2 years after their curse-breaking World Series win, the Sox had found redemption from the dark cloud that hung over Fenway Park. But the second chance they earned didn't guarantee against the occasional lackluster performance. I was thumbing through a throwaway journal, downing another cup of watered-down nurse's station coffee when the words GSW, ETA 1 minute, Trauma Bay 1 came across my pager. We hopped off the dilapidated couch and darted down four flights of stairs, racing towards the emergency room. As we descended on Trauma Bay 1, another page rang out announcing a second gunshot wound victim arriving in Bay 2. The staff surgeon, Dr. Agrawal, attended to the first patient while I grabbed the intern and headed towards the second. 20-year-old man found down in Dorchester Avenue, gunshot wounds to the leg, abdomen, and chest. Pulse 120, blood pressure 50 over palp, announced the paramedic who wheeled in the bloody patient. He's got lactated ringers pouring in, and we've given a few rounds of epinephrine. Wide-eyed and gasping for breath, the patient was panicky and restless, like an injured animal. As we stripped off his clothes with a pair of shears, I made note of more than 20 bullet holes from his thighs to his neck. I passed my stethoscope over his chest, only to hear muffled breath sounds. As the nurse dumped a container of betadine across the young man's chest, the intern and I slid in chest tubes, which were quickly bathed in crimson. His blood pressure dropped precipitously and he lost consciousness. With blood spraying out of the endotracheal tube, the anesthesiologist begged him. "Let's go," I shouted, and motioned to the medical student to hold the elevator to the second floor trauma operating room. As we rolled out of the alcove, a third page came across reading GSW, ETA 2 minutes, trauma bay 3. The intern and the medical student looked up at me in disbelief, and we held our breath as we ascended one floor. In the OR, I drew a 10-blade scalpel across the patient's bloated abdomen, sinking the knife through layers of fat and fascia. We expected to encounter an abdomen full of blood, but as I passed my hand across the patient's liver, spleen, and intestines, we found neither blood, stool, nor bile. Dr. Agrawal joined us as we extended the incision over the chest, quickly dragging across the sternal saw. As we pried open his rib cage, a fountain of blood poured out around the destroyed parenchyma of his right lung. I grabbed a large clamp and tried to get a hold of the hemorrhaging pulmonary vessels. Sam, the medical student, held the suction tip in the chest cavity as liters of blood were evacuated. "We're losing him," the anesthetist uttered matter-of-factly. "We're slamming in blood and we've given rounds of epi and a slug of vasopressin." And we looked up at the monitors. His pulse was essentially non-existent, except for when epinephrine was bolused through his veins. Flaccid and quivering, his heart lay deflated within the mediastinum. The phone rang across the room. "Dr. Agrawal, Bay 3 is bringing up another patient." Defeated, the staff surgeon stepped away from the operating table. As he broke out of his bloodied gown, he muttered, "Sew him up and meet me next door." I stared across the table at Sam. I knew what came next. When the patient flatlined, we would remove the sponges and instruments and then whip stitch the gaping wound closed before taking him to the morgue. Instinctively, I reached into the patient's chest and I cradled his heart in my hands. Weakly contracting, it felt like a frightened dove, wishing it could take flight. I methodically squeezed the weakened muscle between my palms. "Look, Sam, with cardiac massage, you can artificially create a pulse." And we looked up at the monitors. We saw a correlating spike on the electrocardiograph when I compressed the heart. "And when you stopped," I paused, seizing compressions, "the pulse disappears." I guided Sam's hand around the heart. He received it delicately, recognizing the gravity of holding another man's heart. With my hands around his, I instructed him in how to perform cardiac massage, both well aware that as soon as we ceased compressions, our patient would die. We lingered in this rhythmic motion. I asked the anesthetist to drop some epinephrine. Plunging the needle into the myocardium, I demonstrated to Sam how the stimulant caused the muscle fibers to contract. There was a brief burst of myocardial activity that slowly drifted away. As I asked for another milligram of epinephrine, we both watched as the patient flatlined. He was dead. And a silence overcame the room as the monitors registered no sign of life. I handed the syringe to Sam and I had him inject the heart one last time. Surprisingly, a few beeps broke the silence. I surrounded his heart with my hands once again and resumed compressions. "Please, please, please." I silently begged as I watched the spikes reform on the electrocardiograph. After a few minutes, I stopped. Then, independently, a pulse registered on the screen. "Oh my God," I said out loud, "he's alive." The anesthetists continued their efforts and we did the same. I asked the nurse to call Dr. Agrawal. "Are you joking?" he asked in bewilderment. We temporarily closed the patient's abdomen and chest, knowing that we would be back in the operating room at some point in the next few hours for re-exploration. He was taken to the trauma ICU for resuscitation with his 15th unit of blood being transfused. We were invigorated, but knew that the patient would likely succumb to the sequela of cardiac shock. Even if he could make it through the next 24 hours, he had likely sustained a severe anoxic injury. Organ failure was imminent. 2 days later, I passed a newsstand on Harrison Avenue on my way to the hospital. The front page detailed the altercation in Dorchester that brought two young adults and one teenager to Boston Medical Center. I took the elevator up to the ICU where we would make Monday morning rounds with the chief of trauma, Dr. Erwin Hirsch. Iconic and revered, Dr. Hirsch's name was synonymous with trauma surgery in Boston. A veteran of the Vietnam War and Operation Desert Storm, it seemed like he had seen it all. He reminded his disciples that no two traumas were alike, stating, "You're always dealing with the unknown." We rolled a cart full of charts from room to room to discuss the inhabitants of the ICU, paying specific attention to the three that arrived Friday night. With a wry smile, Dr. Hirsch turned to me and said, "Dr. Raskin, please present your patient, Mr. Lazarus." I rotated to another hospital at the end of the week, expecting to hear that our patient had died a few days later in the ICU. The fate of many individuals with similar morbid injuries, I didn't keep in touch after I left. But a month later, I received an email from the nurse practitioner on the trauma service. I scrolled down the message to find no content except for an attached photograph. And the photo revealed a young Black male in a hospital gown, sitting in a wheelchair in front of Boston Medical Center. Smiling, he held a sign that read, "Thank you, Liz." I had no words for this gesture. So reflecting on that night in the operating room, I am reminded of how little control we have over our patients' lives. Despite our best efforts as physicians, some patients live and some die. As we approach the limits of science, we hold out for miracles, we root for the underdog, and we pray for second chances. We are simply midwives in this world, escorting the injured along their journey. Milan Kundera wrote in The Unbearable Lightness of Being that surgery takes the basic imperative of the medical profession to its outermost limits, where the human makes contact with the divine. Surgery is an interface between life and death, and it is a window into the sacred.
Liz, I'm going to join your patient and say, "Thank you, Liz." It's an incredibly powerful story. Not all miracles that we experience are quite this dramatic, but one of the powerful things that reflection does is it establishes habits of mind and allows us to focus basically on things sometimes that we can't process otherwise. And I think this is a beautiful example of reflective writing with great meaning. So thank you, Liz, again. So every 5 years or so, Roberta and I return to Stanford for our alumni gathering. And the last time I went was on the occasion of my 60th year from graduation. And one of the things we like about this particular activity is that we get to hear some really astonishing teachers. They line up their best and their brightest. And one of the speakers that we heard 2 years ago was Jamil Zaki, who's recently written this book called The War for Kindness. And he's a psychologist that spent a great deal of his professional career writing about, thinking about, and studying about empathy, and actually runs a laboratory at Stanford that looks at the neural and psychological factors that have to do with empathy. And I want to bring you back to that tremendous divergence in personalities between two doctors that we looked at in the first slide today. Because one of the things that Dr. Zaki points out, and it's a question that a lot of people have actually asked in the past, is empathy a trait? Is it something that you're born with and you may be lucky and have a lot of it, or unfortunate and have a little of it, or is it a skill? And probably it's a combination of both. But what he points out in a TED talk that I've referenced in the title to this slide and takes about 13 minutes to listen to, and I recommend it highly, is that empathy is a skill, and that actually with the appropriate methodology, you can move this pivot point in the center of the arrows to the left or the right, and hopefully we'll be moving it to your right. And one of the things that is particularly interesting to me and very resonant is one of the things that helps in order to develop empathy is reading. And there have been numerous studies in both the humanism literature and in the medical literature show that people who read tend to be more empathic than people who don't. And particularly people who read imaginative literature. And one of the fathers of medicine actually who read a lot was Sir William Osler. And Elizabeth, why don't you reflect a little bit on what Osler was telling us and what he was telling his students in this essay of his called Equanimitas. Elizabeth?
Just kidding. So Osler lived in the mid 1800s and died at the turn of the century in the 1900s, and is regarded as one of these pivotal individuals who that we looked up to as the pillar of what a physician should be in his diagnostic skills, in his writing, in his ability to describe disease and to treat it. And one of the neat things, though, that he wrote about in this Equanimitas was, and you can see at the top of the paragraph, he told his disciples every day, do some reading or work apart from your profession. I fully realize, no one more so, how absorbing is the profession of medicine, how applicable it is to what Michelangelo says. There are sciences which demand the whole of a man without leaving the least portion of his spirit free for other distractions. But you will be a better man or woman and not a worse practitioner for an avocation. And so I have really taken this to heart, and I try to have my residents really take this to heart, which means read something outside of medicine, learn about the arts, learn about the theater, learn about people, learn about what it is that makes us human, and your life will be richer. Your ability to connect will be richer. Your ability to recognize in someone's story something that's common with your own. We find that in the stories that we tell and the stories that we read. And so here was one of our fathers of modern medicine back in the turn of the century, two centuries ago, I suppose, giving that sage advice, which is be curious about the world around you. And this will enrich your life in so many different ways. And so that's how I interpret Osler's, famous paper here.
So one of the things that stories do is they actually provide for us a passageway into places and experiences that we might never otherwise appreciate. And I thought that this quotation from Ian McEwan, who is a noted British novelist, pretty much defines what it is that we would like our residents to understand, and also describes why it's so important to think about and read about imaginative situations. Imagining what it is like to be someone other than yourself is at the core of our humanity. It is the essence of compassion, and it is the beginning of morality. So we tried to pick a story about empathy, and the one that we selected is from a book by Richard Seltzer, a one-time surgeon at Yale University, passed away a few years ago. Both Elizabeth and I have met Dr. Seltzer and actually heard him talk. And Elizabeth is going to tell you a story from this book called The Exact Location of the Soul, which we think emphasizes and describes empathy in a very meaningful way. Elizabeth.
So this gentleman really had a huge impact in my career. I heard him speak when I was a second year medical student, and it was at a national medical students conference. And he was reading from one of his many books. And I just didn't even know that this was possible, that you could be a doctor and then also be a creative writer. And I thought, this is everything to me because it's what I'd been doing most of my youth and my teenage and 20s. And so when I heard him speak, I was flabbergasted by the vocabulary he used, the play on words, the puns he used. He's just really a clever writer. And so the passage I'm going to read to you today comes from The Exact Location of the Soul. And here it goes. Someone asked me why a surgeon would write. Why, when the shelves are already too full? They sag under the dead weight of books. To add a single adverb is to risk exceeding the strength of the boards. A surgeon should abstain. A surgeon whose fingers are more at home in the steamy gullies of the body than they are tapping the dry keys of a typewriter. A surgeon who feels the slow slide of intestines against the back of his hand and is no more alarmed than would be a family of snakes taking their comfort from such an indolent rubbing. A surgeon who palms the human heart as though it were some captured bird. Why should he write? Is it vanity that urges him? There is glory enough in the knife. Is it for money? One can make too much money. No. It is to search for some meaning in the ritual of surgery, which is at once murderous, painful, healing, and full of love. It is a devilish hard thing to transmit, to find even. Perhaps if one were to cut out a heart, a lobe of the liver, a single convolution of the brain, and paste it to a page, it would speak with more eloquence than all the words of Balzac. Such a piece would need no literary style, no mass of erudition or history, but in its very shape and feel would tell all the frailty and strength, the despair and nobility of man. What? Publish a heart? A little piece of bone? Preposterous. Still, I fear that is what it may require to reveal the truth that lies hidden in the body. Not all the undressings of Rabelais, Chekhov, or even William Carlos Williams have wrested it free, although God knows each one of those doctors made a heroic assault upon it. I have come to believe that it is the flesh alone that counts. The rest is that with which we distract ourselves when we are not hungry or cold, in pain or ecstasy. In the recesses of the body, I search for the philosopher's stone. I know it is there, hidden in the deepest, dampest cul-de-sac. It awaits discovery. To find it would be like the harnessing of fire. It would illuminate the world. Such a quest is not without pain. Who can gaze on so much misery and feel no hurt? Emerson has written that the poet is the only true doctor. I believe him, for the poet, lacking the impediment of speech with which the rest of us are afflicted, gazes, records, diagnoses, and prophecies. I invited a young diabetic woman to the operating room to amputate her leg. She could not see the great shaggy black ulcer upon her foot and ankle that threatened to encroach upon the rest of her body, for she was blind as well. There upon her foot was a Mississippi Delta brimming with corruption, sending its raw tributaries down between her toes. And gone were all the little web spaces that, when fresh and whole, are such a delight to loving men. She could not see her wound, but she could feel it. And there is no pain like that of a bloodless limb turned rotten and festering. There is neither unguent nor anodyne to kill such a pain, yet leave intact the body. For over a year, I trimmed away the putrid flesh, cleansed, anointed, and dressed the foot, staving off delaying. Three times each week in In her darkness, she sat upon my table, rocking back and forth, holding her extended leg by the thigh, gripping it as though it were a rocket that must be steadied lest it explode and scatter her toes about the room. And I would cut away a bit here, a bit there, of the swollen blue leather that was her tissue. At last we gave up, she and I. We could no longer run ahead of the gangrene. We had not the legs for it. There must be an amputation in order that she might live, and I as well. It was to heal us both that I must take up knife and saw and cut the leg off. And when I could feel it drop from her body to the table, see the blessed space appear between her leg and that leg, I would too be well. Now is the day of the operation. I stand by while the anesthetist administers the drugs, watch as the tense, familiar body relaxes into narcosis. I turn then to uncover the leg. And there, upon her kneecap, she has drawn blindly, upside down for me to see, a face. Just a circle with two ears, two eyes, a nose, and a smiling upturned mouth. Under it, she has printed, "Smile, doctor." Minutes later, I listen to the sound of the saw until a little crack at the end tells me it is done. So I have learned that man is not ugly, but that he is beauty itself. There is no other his equal. Are we not all dying, none faster or more slowly than any other? I have become receptive to the possibilities of love, for it is love, this thing that happens in the operating room. And each day I wait, trembling in the busy air. Perhaps today it will come. Perhaps today I will find it, take part in it, this love that blooms in the stoniest desert.
Wow. Thank you, Elizabeth. That was a beautiful way to tell a very wonderful story and make the point of what empathy means. So we're going to talk a little bit about listening and healing. And for this, I'm turning to one of my heroes. It's Dr. Rachel Naomi Remen. And she's shown here as a young physician and now as a senior statesman. I was really very fortunate a few years ago to spend a week with her in a course that she gives called The Healer's Art. It's a course that she started at UCSF on the down low, as they say, but it was immediately recognized as a tremendous asset by the dean at UCSF. It's now part of their regular curriculum. And what's astonishing is that it's become a part of the curriculum at over 100 medical schools in the United States. And what the course teaches is a lot of what we're discussing today, the importance of connecting and of listening and ultimately of healing. And I'm going to let her tell you a little bit about listening, because when she described this to our class, it immediately struck a chord with me because I realized that many of the things that she mentions here are things that I was doing, and a lot of things that are important are things that I wasn't doing. And I've tried to pass this lesson on to my students and try also to remember it.
Spirituality can have profound effects on healing for many patients, yet practitioners often feel that they are not qualified to discuss spiritual issues with their patients. Listen in as Rachel Remen, MD, explains why spirituality doesn't always require expertise, and the one thing we can do that might help our patients most.
Spirituality isn't a question of expertise. It's a question of humanity. You know, such a simple question as saying to someone, you know, you've been through a lot, what's important now? And then listening, really listening. not to analyze or to figure out what's needed next or what's wrong with this answer, but simply to know what's true for that other person, what we call generous listening, right?
Generous listening,
not to do the sort of things that you usually do when you're listening, whether you're aware of them or not. Do I like what I'm hearing? Do I agree with what I'm hearing? Do I like who's talking? Is this person more educated than I, better trained than I, less trained than I, smarter than I? I mean, we get very busy. And of course, we also we're trained to listen. What's wrong with the other person? Do I know how to fix it? If I don't know how to fix it, do I know somebody I can bring in who can fix it? I mean, we can't hear anybody. But in generous listening, which is the only rule for this kind of a group, really, in generous listening, you don't even listen in order to understand why the other person feels the way they do. It doesn't matter why. What matters is what's true for this person. And you simply receive it and respect it. And in that safe interaction, something can happen which is larger than before. And that's all you need. You are enough. What we do is close down and make it impossible for us to have these kinds of very strengthening communications. And you know, a spiritual communication strengthens both people.
Yes.
Just being heard and being honored with whatever it was that the other person said, that they trusted you to tell you this and to share this because it's important to them what they're going to tell you. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, these things strengthen us.
It's important not only...
So I hope you have an idea about generous listening. And I wanted to spend just a moment or two talking about the difference between healing and curing. One of the points that Elizabeth made earlier on this evening, that's something that all of us have to reckon with, is that we can't fix everybody and that we have to acknowledge the fact, she did this when we were talking about humility. And so we have to recognize that when we can't fix things, is there anything else that we can offer? And Rachel teaches us about healing and how it is differentiated from curing. She says there's a great more to wholeness than the recovery of physical health, and so much more to medicine than curing disease. Over time, I've come to think of physical health not as a goal, but as a means that enables people to pursue what has meaning and value in life. And I think that's one of our responsibilities, is to try and ensure that our patients, even when they're desperately ill, can find some meaning in the illness and in their life. To help others to heal, we need to bring our own wholeness with us into the examining room. Our strengths, our courage, our caring, our vulnerability, even at times, our anger and our fears. And then finally, she says, stories take the facts of a life and infuse them with meaning. They inspire us, feed us, heal us when we have been wounded. It's not possible to live well without stories, I think. So our last story actually comes from a book called God's Hotel. And I've selected a chapter called The Miraculous Healing of Terry Becker to give you some idea of what we talk about when we talk about healing. First of all, Laguna Hospital, as it's shown here, no longer exists in San Francisco. But when I was a fellow in San Francisco, it was a source of wonderment to me because it was a place where I could send my patients when there was no place else to send them if they were homeless or required months and months of rehabilitative care. Victoria Sweet was a doctor of great compassion and great skill, but she became very interested in the history of medicine, and particularly a part of medicine that's called pre-modern medicine. And she became fascinated by Hildegard von Bingen, who was a polymath, a nun, a great composer, and she ran what was basically a hospice in Germany. And in order to learn more about Hildegard and to learn more about pre-modern medicine, Victoria learned that she had to study. And to do that, she had to have time. She had a very flourishing and apparently excellent practice, but in order to provide her with time, she went to Laguna Hospital and applied for a position that would enable her to spend less than full time practicing medicine. She was accepted and spent a number of years accumulating stories and writing stories, and ultimately coming up with a book called God's Hotel. She followed that just a few years ago with another book called Slow Medicine. That's a play on fast food and slow food. Basically, we all know what fast food is, and I hope we know what slow food is. I don't know that if we've had much experience actually with slow medicine, but at the time that she was there, that was what they practiced at Laguna Honda Hospital. And I'm going to read you a little bit of this story called The Miraculous Healing of Terry Becker. Then Connie turned Terry on her left side, and I saw the open wound on her back. The description from the county hospital had not done it justice. Terry's bed sore was the worst I've ever seen. It was huge, enormous, and deep. It went from the middle of her back all the way down to her tailbone, and it spanned both of her sit bones. The skin was completely gone, of course, but so too were the fat and muscles that cover the spine. In their place was an unidentified mass of decayed and decaying and infected tissue from the failed skin graft. And at the bottom of this wide, deep hole, I could see bone. Terry's spine. Now, before I came to Laguna Honda, and even for a while after, I did not understand the importance of a bed sore. Doesn't sound that bad, a sore from lying in bed. In fact, though, bed sores are a disaster, both in what they mean and what they signify. They mean that someone has not been paying attention to the difficult problem of a patient like Terry, who no longer feels the lower part of her body, and so does not make the unconscious, fidgety movements the rest of us make to relieve pressure on the parts of our body pressed against shoes, chair, bedclothes. What bed sores signify is even worse. They signify that the body has lost its integrity. Normally, the body is covered with skin, which is impermeable to fluid and germs. Slather healthy skin with any amount of germs and nothing will happen, no infection, unless there's a break in the skin. As extra protection, there's the fat under the skin, which cushions the muscles, and the muscles under the fat, which protect the bones, and the bones, which protect the spinal cord. For the second time with the patient, I thought about Hildegard, and I asked myself, what would Hildegard do? How would she treat Terry Becker's huge and open wound? And as I did so, I stared into Mrs. McCoy's green plant. What she would do, I suddenly saw, was remove the obstructions to Terry's viriditas, to Terry's natural ability to heal. Because if nothing was in its way, then viriditas would heal her wound as surely as a plant will grow green. What was in its way, I asked myself. The mass of dead tissue was in its way, and every bit of it had to be removed. Any pressure on Terry's body, from wrinkled bedclothes to hard mattresses, was also in its way and had to be removed. anything that interfered with the circulation of her blood. Nicotine, for instance, was in the way of viriditas. Dirt, unkemptness, stale clothes, unnecessary medications, fear, depression, hopelessness, all were in the way. My first job, therefore, as a gardener doctor, was not to make a brilliant diagnosis or give any magical medication, but to remove obstructions to Terry's own viriditas. What else? To see what else was needed, I had to start with a vision of Terry whole, complete, and healthy, in a future when all that was missing from her complete health was a pair of glasses, and walk my way back from that, which I did. I walked past the repair of her teeth, the strengthening of her body, the strengthening of her will, the resolution of her depression, and the healing of her bed sore. I walked all the way back from the perfect future to the imperfect now. And then I organized my strategy forward. What my strategy would be, I understood from Hildegard, was that in addition to removing obstructions to viriditas, I would fortify Terry's viriditas with earth, water, air, and fire. That is, with good nutrition, tasty food, vitamins, liquids, deep sleep, fresh air, and sunlight. After that, peace, rest, safety. Not much else. It might be just that simple. Oh, and time, as much time as Terry needed. It was quite amazing how fast Hildegard's prescription worked. Within a few weeks, I began to see signs of healing deep within Terry's wound. There was no infection, and deep down at the base of the wound, was it my imagination? There was smooth and pink glistening, which was starting to cover and protect her spine. But then the first of the month rolled around and Mike showed up. He was still pretty cute, still wearing his tight Levi's, still walking with a flirtatious, though constrained strut. The nurses made him wait in the waiting room, and Terry wheeled herself in on a gurney, face down, back covered, the whole length of the ward. Then she rolled into the smoking room. They were there for a long time. Then the door opened and Mike came out and left. Terry had thrown him out. She told him never to come back. Then she stopped smoking, so her appetite improved, and she gained weight without nicotine constricting her blood vessels. The tiny new arteries and vein at the base of her bed sore could absorb the vitamins and protein she was eating, and the hole in her backside began to fill in. Since I did not check the bed sore daily, but only once a week, its progress seemed as magical to me as one of those time-lapse movies they showed us in school, where a plant grows from a seed in a matter of minutes. Dirt falls on either side of the sprout as it pushes its way up through the earth. Then a minute later, tiny leaves unfurl, buds appear, and then expand until their sides split open and the first petals unfurl. It took a long time. It took 2.5 years, but we were in no hurry, and neither was she. After 2.5 years, the bed sore had healed. Also, Terry's teeth had been repaired by our dentist and eyeglasses prescribed by our optometrist. She gained a considerable amount of weight. The crevices in her face had filled in. Her hair grew in thick and dark, and behind her new eyeglasses, makeup appeared. I think I'm going to stop there in the interest of time, because I think you get the picture. Viriditas is something that may be an attitude or an understanding from pre-modern medicine, but it certainly has importance today. And it's one of the things that is probably in the essence of healing. We have one more slide, and I've assigned it to Elizabeth unfairly because it's of a very famous pulmonary physician. But Elizabeth, you want to comment on Edward Livingston Trudeau? Yeah.
So, you know, what's an interesting thing, a famous pulmonologist, this gentleman was alive at the time of Osler. They basically overlapped almost exactly the mid-1800s to the early 1900s. And Edward Livingston Trudeau was an American physician who was a public health pioneer, really in the era before antibiotics were created. And he was really responsible for recognizing the role of crowding, of people crowding in transmission of disease, which is so salient right now to what's going on with COVID and other communicable diseases. He saw the utility of isolating people, especially with tuberculosis, and then was a real big proponent of notifying when disease was present. And so all really the basics and the foundation for public health medicine, this gentleman was practicing this in that era. And the other interesting thing that I find about him is that he was a tuberculosis specialist. Well, my grandfather, who was the first physician in my family, he graduated from medical school in 1930s. His PhD was in microbiology, and his PhD paper was on describing the lipid bilayer or the cell membrane of the tubercle bacillus, which is tuberculosis. And so I found commonality in the fact that he studied tuberculosis. My grandfather, who was one of the many that inspired me into medicine, was a tuberculosis expert. And this gentleman is quite well known, but one of the things that he has said, and I think this is really important to all of us, is that physicians need to be reminded of this, that, you know, to cure sometimes when we can, to relieve often, to try our best to relieve pain and disease, but to comfort always. Comfort is that care, it's the medicine that we can always deliver, whether we're able to cure, whether we're able to stop a disease process that is happening. That is one thing that we can do as physicians, but as we can do as non-physicians, is we can be there as a source of comfort for those who suffer. And I think that's at the heart of what makes us most human.
Thanks a lot, Elizabeth. So we're gonna stop the screen share, and we apologize for taking so long, but we had spent a lot of time winnowing and editing and thought that we would have something finished in an hour. Of course, we didn't. So there is some time for questions and discussion, and we'd certainly like to hear from anyone who has some opinions or experiences or stories that they would like to share with the rest of us.
Thank you, Doctor. Before we get started, if you would like to ask a question, please put your name in the chat box. And before we do that, I'd just like to remind everyone that we have programs on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, starting tomorrow, Wednesday and Thursday. Rabbi Heather Miller is the new rabbi of BCC in Los Angeles, and we have had her predecessor speak at Congregation Emmanuel. Jerry Ripley certainly needs no introduction, and we are honored to have him perform for us on Wednesday. And you may also remember Dr. Fran Grace, who has done a program with us in the past. I hope you join us, because although these three speakers have, they've got a lot ahead of them to try to step up to the same level of what you saw tonight, I'm confident that they will. Let's start off the Q&A with Nancy. Go ahead and unmute yourself, and please ask your question.
Okay, I'm afraid it's not a question. It's a story, and it is a story about Phil. So one day I was meeting a friend of mine in a restaurant for lunch, and I walked in and to the restaurant, and before I saw my friend even, I saw Phil Gold. And he was with a whole bunch of rather young people. Okay, I don't know, I probably sort of indicated hello to him. And then I sat down with my friend, and we were close enough that I could overhear what was going on at that very large table. And I know Phil Gold, he's a physician, right? And he teaches. But as I listened, eavesdropping, sorry, Phil. He was talking about poetry. They were reading poetry. And I thought, huh? What's going on? And if any of you know me, know that I really like poetry. So this really hit the spot with me. So afterward, you know, I went up, I think when my friend and I left and just said hello. But then as soon as I could see him outside, probably at the temple, I said, what were you doing? Well, he was teaching a class. And he was helping students to come into connection with their own feelings and their own thoughts in a way that was direct to the heart. And he was using poetry. And I thought, oh, this is so wonderful. Talk about connection.
I remember that very well.
What a lovely story. Rabbi Cohn, you had a quick comment? Please feel free to unmute yourself if you can.
Thank you so much to Dr. Gold and Dr. Raskin. I've not met Dr. Raskin, but I think I've known Dr. Gold for a little while. Thank you very much for the presentation. I want to just point out one thing, the importance of empathy. And just to recall, when I was a rabbinic student in the late 1950s, early 1960s, the Reform movement was the first to introduce the study of what was called then human relations, then became called pastoral psychology, based really on the work of Joshua Loth Liebman's book, Peace of Mind. And Dr. Robert Katz, who was our professor in Cincinnati, introduced us to the whole idea of empathy, which really was a word that was not used. You talked about sympathy, not empathy. And he pointed really to a text out of the Pirkei Avot, which says, Al tadin chaverecha ad shetagia lemkomo. Don't judge your neighbor until you have stood in that person's place. And that was his proof text for the idea of empathy. So I just want to pass that on. But my question to both the Dr. Gold and Dr. Raskin is, and it really comes out of my own family's personal experience. As Dr. Gold knows, my wife had open heart surgery and then back surgery, both done at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. And we went there for a particular reason, because with all of the expertise of hospitals in the Inland Empire, Southern California, and so on, it was felt that the one thing that was generally missing was coordination between various specialties. And the two places in the country that were felt to be the experts that were the Mayo Clinic and the Cleveland Clinic. I don't know whether that has something to do with humility, but the whole idea that people in one specialty of medicine don't always communicate freely with someone in the other specialties. Would you comment on that? Is that a matter of humility or what? And do you find that to be a problem in contemporary medicine?
I think it's a matter of what's currently referred to as culture. And every institution has its own culture. And for many reasons, the Mayo Clinic certainly for many years has had this culture of interdisciplinary cooperation. When people go to the Mayo Clinic, they often have a list of three or four doctors that they're going to see in succession, and it's all coordinated. The one thing I'll tell you about the Mayo Clinic that bears on some of the things that we talked about today, because they're always interested in evaluating their practice and their performance. And one of the tragedies of contemporary medicine that has nothing to do with COVID, but has a lot to do actually with depersonalization and with time issues, is what's called physician burnout or caregiver burnout. And the Mayo Clinic actually started a program where they got doctors in groups together just to read stories. And other doctors served as controls. And at the end of a period, they evaluated these two groups of doctors to determine whether there was more or less burnout in either group. And it turns out the doctors who were meeting to read stories together were less likely to show evidence of physician burnout. So kudos to the Mayo Clinic.
I'd like to keep moving if I could. Can we go to Celia?
I appreciate your presentation regarding connection and empathy. Here in the desert, you spend a lot of time trying to find a physician that you can communicate with, you feel comfortable with. But once my husband was admitted to the hospital, they were not allowed to be there. And we had a hospitalist, a totally strange physician, looking at this person, and there was no connection. They were looking at the paperwork and the blood work and the x-rays and the blah, blah, blahs. If I wasn't there to intercede, I don't know if my husband would have known which doctors were there. And there was an attending, and then there were two residents who changed every 3 weeks. And then there were some interns who changed every week. And so I felt very alone and isolated because the people who we found and felt comfortable with were not allowed to be there. Do you have any comments? And is that just, is that unique to our facility out here? Because Eisenhower Hospital is now a teaching hospital. Thank you.
I think that's not unique to this area, but it is this, it is the evolution of modern medicine where we need physicians that are on duty at certain hours. The volume of work that we have to take care of is enormous, and it can be hard to have a practice outside of the hospital and within the hospital when our services can have hundreds of patients on them. And so I think it can depersonalize at times. It can be isolating, especially when you're now, when family can barely even visit. We're just now allowing patients' families, well, patient can have one visitor at a time and only a certain number per day, one or two a day. But it was where they couldn't even have any visitors. They couldn't have a spouse. They couldn't be in delivering a baby and have their spouse there. I mean, this was awful for COVID. But I would say that system that you're describing is very common, and it is all over the United States. Sometimes it can provide better care. But one of the things you lose is that these are brand new people, and they have to establish relationships every single day with brand new individuals. And then maybe they're on duty for a few days in a row, and then they turn over. On some levels, it allows them to have good attention to detail, where they're not going to let things slip through the cracks. Because if you're doing that intense work over and over and over again for weeks at a time, there's no break. It is very overwhelming. And I know that as a surgeon, for the sort of hours that we put in, there are some sorts of surgery services that have come to shift work. And it is a mirroring what they do in the emergency room. So we have what we call acute care surgeons, surgeons that are on call for the night, and they may not be the surgeon you know or you've seen, but they take care of whomever comes in the door at the time, and then they rotate off service at a certain time. My practice is not like that. I take call every other week, every other weekend, sometimes every night, depending on if I have patients in the hospital that I need to care for. But that's at the expense of a lot of invested time and a lot of time away from my family. And so I think when you have systems like you're describing, these are ways to try to find better work-life balance for physicians. But the problem is that we lose that personal touch at times, and we've got to figure out how we can be more like that pediatrician with the needle, da, 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 with our adult patients too, to spend enough time to make them feel loved and cared for. And so one thing that I have found that helps is to be a physician that smiles a lot. You know, I'm someone, I tell my residents, I fluctuate between hypomania and mania, where I'm happy at a low level. I am really happy, but I rarely come into work at a low level because I know that sets the tone for what the day is going to be like. And I know that it sets the tone for what my residents are going to do and my patients are going to feel. So I think we need to be reminded of that. And so as Phil was alluding to, physicians that read, physicians that do something outside of work and they love that, can hopefully replenish themselves so that they can care for people during these long and challenging hours, because it really can be taxing, and burnout is a very real thing.
Thank you, Doctor. Deb Holder, you have a question.
Yeah, hi. First of all, that was a very interesting presentation. Thank you, both of you. Anyway, the reason I was interested in this is that I'm a medical social worker and I don't work in a hospital setting, I'm outpatient, but I have found that my role often is as an advocate for the patient. I think a lot of doctors working as on an interdisciplinary team, I find that maybe it's the sheer number of patients that doctors have and the lack of time that they have to spend with each one. But my role a lot of times is to have to be the advocate and ask a doctor, hey, pay attention to this. This is important. And trying to sometimes even have to argue with the doctor about, you know, what the patient wants because the doctor hasn't actually listened. And so a lot of what you were saying, you described like perfect doctors, which is wonderful. But the reality is that often doesn't exist. And I'm sure, as you said, most people probably start out wanting to be that way, but it doesn't turn out. So how do we address this complete shortage of doctors with these high number of patients and not enough time to spend with anyone?
I'm gonna take a page from Joe Biden and say, God love you. But in fact, there is a shortage of social workers, just like there's a shortage of physicians. It's ironic in a way, because one of the things that has been stressed so much recently in terms of the actual practice of the medicine is the fact that we work in teams, and the whole concept of the role of the team members is stressed a lot in education. But when it gets to the practical reality, one of the persons I think is most important on the team is a social worker, and they can save us so much time and aggravation and make things so much better for the patient. And yet in the time that I was in practice at Loma Linda, which spanned 40 years, I saw the number of social workers that we had in the hospital cut by over a half. And in fact, in the office practice of medicine, it was almost impossible to get the services of a social worker. And so you bring up some very, very important points, Deb, and like I said, God love you.
I think the most important thing is that you are an advocate, because for me, I know I can't do everything all the time, and I really rely on the people that surround me. I don't pretend to be somebody who can do it all. I make a lot of mistakes, mostly at home, not usually in the operating room, but although I sometimes do. But you have to be humble enough to recognize we are a key component to the team, but we are not the entire team. And the team is comprised of many different layers. And I just hope that you can find physicians that you work with that can see you as a collaborator, because that's what I see our nurses, our staff members, our nursing assistants, anybody who I interface with is a team member in this big project. And if a physician does not view the world that way, I think it's really sad, because the patients lose out in the long run. We're not here because of ourselves. You know, we're here because of that calling to help others. And it's unfortunate that this idea that physicians are godlike or somehow above us is so ridiculous. My greatest joy is in actually the patient not even recognizing that I'm the physician, but just someone that they like when I walk in the door. Sometimes I bring their food in that's sitting outside, and then they even like me more. So, but what I would say is you are a huge component to the success of a patient's care, as are the nurses and the other staff members. The therapists that we work with are so important. It's not just one person at the heart of the care.
And please don't misunderstand. I'm not saying all the doctors are are not respecting what I have to bring to the table. I'm just saying there's so little time that they have. And sometimes, on occasion, I have to really fight for the patient because there's, you know, when I was in dialysis, you know, here's 2 seconds with the patient and then they move on to the next person. And I'm like, wait, I just spent the last 45 minutes with them and I know exactly what's going on.
And family needs to do that too. Family really needs to help advocate if the patient is unable to do that themselves. Mm-hmm. And all I can say is the squeaky wheel gets the grease. And I tell everybody that, do not be afraid to say something, because if you do, you're the only one who is going to miss out if it's an unfortunate situation where you're not getting the attention needed.
I see Dr. Jeff Rosenfeld there. He has established an amazing unit for the care of patients with neuromuscular disease. And I'm sure that he depends very heavily on the work of social workers. Jeff, you want to comment on what your situation is as far as having sufficient workers to help with patient needs?
Sure. Actually, it's what brought me to Loma Linda was the opportunity to fill a void that I saw here to provide that kind of care. I practice as a neurologist, and I chose neurology as my field in medicine because amongst all of them, it was the one where I thought the art of practice was as important as the science of practice. And one of the things that struck me very early on in my career was that one thing that's common amongst lots of different neurological conditions was the fact that our patients have difficulty walking or ambulating for various reasons, but they don't have an easy time getting from place to place. And the diseases affected many different systems in the body. So we were asking patients to do the most what they could do the least, go from one visit to the next visit and back and forth. So creating a multidisciplinary program, which is what I've been able to build at Loma Linda and at two places prior to Loma Linda, has been probably the most gratifying aspect of my practice. And on my team, practicing with me every day, seeing almost all of my patients, is an occupational therapist, a physical therapist, a respiratory therapist, a dietitian, a nutritionist, and a counselor, a social worker, or behavioral medicine specialist. And almost everybody sees everybody each time they come. So the visits are very comprehensive, but very complete. And it's a holistic approach that is among one of the missions at Loma Linda, but not that common, really. I think it was one of the voids that I saw that brought me here. So thank you, Phil.
God love you too.
Time for just 2 more comments. Kathy, do you have anything more from your kitchen?
Yes, I do. Dr. Raskin, you're a wonderful writer. I feel that your writing is your therapy. As you said, you have to have an outside interest. Those of you know Jeff, this is his outside interest. He turns wood, bowls, pens. Have you published? I would love to buy a book if you've published. Have you published your stories? Because they're wonderful.
I have some of my works published in journals. It's what I seek to do once I accumulate enough information or enough time to write the stories down. But I am actively writing a story now, and I have recently finished a work that is a little bit of science fiction that hopefully I can read to you a little later in the year. But it is called The Visitors. And it's a different genre for me to take, but it is all based in medicine. So someday I hope to pursue that passion a little bit more intensely. Right now it's in the few little moments that I get when there isn't a child screaming or when I'm not, you know, waking up at 4:30 in the morning to try to go running or something crazy. So, but I thank you for that feedback. My writing means a lot to me, and I think it is truly therapy. And I think that we can all learn a lot by journaling and writing our thoughts down, even if we don't have necessarily, if we don't perceive ourselves as talented in writing, still the act of writing is a spiritual act and act of reflection that I think we could all benefit from. So I thank you for those comments.
Let me know.
I will.
Thank you.
Let's finish up in Sacramento with Michael Kress. Mike, you still there? There he is.
I'm still there. I just had to find the unmute button. I have too many screens up. So I just wanted to make a comment. It kind of goes along with what Rabbi Cohn was talking about in terms of going to the Mayo Clinic, and maybe kind of a heads up to others who might think of moving. One of the last things we really thought about when we moved to Sacramento was medical care. And we were used to having great medical care, great doctors in Redlands and Loma Linda. And when we moved up here, we thought we would start checking into what was available for doctors. And we ran into the Medicare wall, which means that if you're on Medicare, a lot of doctors don't have any time for you. They don't have any openings for you. And it was simply by accident that I saw an ad for UC Davis Medical Group on PBS, on a PBS program that I was watching, and called them up and they said, oh, absolutely, we love Medicare patients. And so far we have had extremely good luck, but with most, we sometimes get fellows and residents that change all the time, but pretty much the medical care, we feel like we're getting really significant medical care. One of the things that I never thought about personally was, because Renee had all of the medical issues when we were in Redlands and Loma Linda, was me, and I ended up in the hospital last year with pneumonia, and ran into the same issue that the doctor that I'd been seeing, our family physician, wasn't of course the doctor that I saw in the hospital. I saw four different doctors over 2 days. And when they discharged me, they said, oh, you need to make an appointment and go see your family physician for your extended care on this, which worked out fine. He's an excellent physician and spends a lot of time with us. But had I thought about medical care in a little more detail, we would have probably started the year before looking for doctors up here before we actually moved. And then there would have been a lot more coordination in our medical care, because once we moved up here, now we were disconnected from the people that we had in Redlands, and we were now having to make new connections and try to get prescriptions, and everything else was a chore at first. We're now ensconced in the UC Davis medical system, which is working out really well. And we find their doctors, although they're younger than our own kids, are excellent and do their best to spend a lot more time with us than we ever figured we'd be able to spend with them. But it's been a good experience. But my warning to anyone that's going to move in their senior years closer to where their kids are, start planning ahead for how you're going to get your medical care, particularly if you have medical issues that need to be taken care of on a continuing basis, and medications too. And that's right, medications. That's all really I wanted to make a comment on. And thank you to both of you for your excellent stories and a lot of thought-provoking things that you said and other people have said. So I'm kind of glad I got to hear this. So, thank you.
You know, I think we're all incredibly grateful, and let's give a Zoom round of applause, which looks like this, if you haven't done one, to Dr. Gold and Dr. Raskin. Thank you both so much for all of your hard work, for everything that you've done, and for enlightening us, and for a program that won't soon be forgotten. Folks, I hope that you join us again tomorrow, same bat time, same bat channel, for our program tomorrow. And I will see you all then. Have a great night.
Thanks, Stuart, very much.
And thanks, everybody.
Rabbi Cantor, Elizabeth, thank you all.
Thanks, Phil, for the collaboration.
Blessings to you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Nice to see you, Chris.
Great job. Thank you, Dr. Spencer.
Your writing is really incredible. We definitely want to hear more.
Time for the book.
I would love to. I mean, I honestly, that's where I want to go with part of my career now. And some of the new things that I'm trialing out, I just find that it's helpful for me, but it's also helpful for others.
So I think this was a nice forum to hear that, honestly.
Hadn't read any of those things out loud to anybody. So.
We should plan on another reading for you.
Sure.
I wanted to comment, Dr. Raskin, on your story about the ER with the gunshot wound patient. Because not everyone takes the time. So you said, oh yeah, this is what doctors do. And I do think a lot will try, but some people go that extra mile. And that's what you did. You went that extra mile to save this person's life, whereas some other people who might be more jaded or burnt out might not have done that. So you really saved this person's life. And I'm sure, I keep hearing echoes. It's amazing. I mean, so good for you for doing that. It's really inspiring to hear that.
I don't know if I knew at the time. I was a senior resident, and I think that some of these things are instinct, and they don't always turn out like that. So, I mean, that was a really magical moment, but we have a lot of other ones that aren't so magical that we don't write stories about. So I think that I felt the sanctity and the sacredness of that moment, and I always reflect on it. So it isn't something I take lightly, but I try to share with others, even if it's just to be in the presence of someone who's dying, because that's a powerful thing, and we need to be with patients that die, even if we can't save them, to do your best and to recognize that every life is important. And I think, you know, the sad thing about stories like that is these young men who we take in and have been shot and have all these traumatic injuries, they get out of the hospital, and it's really sad to see them back in the trauma area, which I'm not a trauma surgeon, but I saw people back in the trauma area when I was a resident. And that means that they were involved in this kind of gang violence at the time. And that's the thing we want to stop. We want the prevention and not have to do the heroic things in the operating room. So it tells a story that's actually really salient right now. I didn't think about it until I started to read the story about, you know, as we really engage in spending some very specific time and energy addressing Black Lives Matter and these sort of movements, is to recognize this was something going on, and I didn't even recognize it as a pandemic. That's a pandemic in and of itself, and it continues. You know, three young men in one altercation, one night, and that happens all over the United States, and it happens every day of the year. And that's the poignant part to me that kind of got under my skin after reading it again.
Well, folks, I encourage you to keep reaching out to each other, but I apologize. I've got house guests, and I do have a loud booming voice. So it's time for me to sign off for the night.
Good night, everyone. Thank you so much, everyone. Dr. Raskin. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Manfred, for your comments.
We are grateful for all of you. We'll see you back here tomorrow night at 7.
Thanks, everyone. We'll see you then.